Hello friends, welcome to Kamath Astrology. And today we are going to cover a very interesting topic, that is understanding nakshatras in Vedic astrology. So nakshatras are very important in Vedic astrology, and we will try to understand these nakshatras today. So before I start this topic, I want to pay my respects to Swami Samarth, who I treat as my guru and my guide in life. I hope Swami guides me in making this video an excellent video. Now, before we understand nakshatras, we first need to understand what exactly is the zodiac belt. Now, imagine that the space around the earth, okay, is a circle. All right, that is the sky surrounding the earth is a circle. And let us divide this circle into 12 equal parts. Okay, so this circle is known as the zodiac belt. Now you divide this zodiac belt into 12 equal parts. Now we know that a circle is 360 degrees. So if you divide 360 degrees into 12 equal parts, you will get 12 parts each of 30 degrees. Correct? So if you look carefully in this picture, you can see 12 signs, okay, and each sign is 30 degrees in length. That is, each sign is an arc of 30 degrees, okay. Now, each of these 12 signs is given a name in Vedic astrology. Now, what you see in this picture are the English names for the various signs, okay. So, there are 12 signs, that is Aries, Taurus, Gemini, Cancer, Leo, Virgo, Libra, Scorpio, Sagittarius, Capricorn, Aquarius, and Pisces. Now, these are the English names for the signs. Okay, you can think of each sign as a house in Vedic astrology. So, this is how the zodiac belt looks like. Okay. So the first sign is Aries. In Hindi, it is also known as Mesh. The second sign is Taurus. It is also known as Vrishabh. Third sign is Gemini. It is also known as Mithun. Fourth sign is Cancer. It is also known as Karka. Fifth sign is Simha. It is also known as Leo. Sixth sign is Kanya. It is also known as Virgo. The seventh sign is Libra. It is also known as Tula. Eighth sign is Scorpio. It is also known as Vrishik. The ninth sign is Sagittarius. It is also known as Dhanu. Tenth sign is Makar, which is also known as Capricorn. 11th sign is Aquarius, also known as Kumbha. And the 12th sign is Pisces, which is also known as Meen. So these are the 12 signs in the zodiac belt, or you can think of them as 12 houses constituting the zodiac belt. Now this slide is just a recap of what I have said. So you can see the English names of the sign and the corresponding Hindi name for the sign. Okay. So there are 12 signs, and you can see the Hindi names for the signs corresponding to the respective English names. Now look at this picture very carefully. This is how the zodiac belt is represented as a horoscope. Okay, so you can see that the Rashi number 1 or the sign number 1 shown in this picture is Mesha or Aries. Okay, so what happens here, in this picture, each arc of 30 degrees or each house which you saw in the zodiac belt earlier is represented as a square. So in this picture you can see 12 squares, right? And each square represents one house of the zodiac belt. So the natural zodiac belt starts with Aries. Okay, so it is represented as Rashi 1 here. Aries is also known as Mesha. You move clockwise, the second sign is Taurus, which is also known as Vrishabh. Okay, the third square is Gemini, which is also known as Mithun. Fourth square is Cancer, which is also known as Karka. The fifth square is Leo, which is also known as Simha. And so on, you proceed up to Rashi 12. The 12th square is Meena, which is also known as Pisces. Okay. Now, each of these houses or these signs has a lord. Okay. Has a planetary lord. So, if you see the Rashi number 1 and Rashi number 8. Okay. Rashi number 1 is Mesha or Aries. And Rashi number 8 is Vrishik or Scorpio. So, the owner of these signs is nothing but Mangal or Mars in Vedic astrology. Look at Rashi number 2 and Rashi number 7. Okay, so these are the signs of Taurus and Libra, or I would say Rishabh and Tula Rashi. Okay, so the lord of these signs is Venus or Shukra. Likewise, the lord of Rashi 3, that is Gemini or Mithun sign, is Buddha or Mercury. And the lord of Rashi 6, that is Kanya or Virgo, is again Buddha or Mercury. Alright, Rashi 4, that is the sign of Cancer or Karka, has Chandra as the lord, that is the moon is the lord of this sign. Rashi 5, that is Leo, has the sun as its lord, who is also known as Surya. Okay, go to Rashi 9 and Rashi 12, which are Dhanu Rashi and Meen Rashi. The lord of these signs is Jupiter or Guru. And if you look at the signs in black, that is Rashi 10 and Rashi 11, which are known as Makar and Kumbh Rashi, the lord of these two signs is Shani or Saturn. Okay, so this is how the basic horoscope structure is represented in Vedic astrology. Okay, each of these squares is actually an arc of 30 degrees. So now that this is the basic structure of a horoscope, let us try to understand what is meant by a person's Janma Rashi. Okay. Now, when you are born on a particular date, at a particular time and at a particular place, right? And these three details are used to cast the horoscope. Now, what exactly is meant by the horoscope? Okay. So, horoscope gives the placement of planets in these 12 signs at the time of your birth. Okay. Now, in Vedic astrology, we consider 7 planets and 2 nodes. Okay. So, the 7 planets are Moon, that is Chandra, Mars, that is Mangal, Guru, that is Jupiter, okay, Shukra, that is Venus, Sun, that is Surya, Mercury, that is Buddha, and Saturn, that is Shani. Okay, and apart from this, there are two nodes which we consider, that is Rahu and Ketu. Now, Rahu and Ketu are not planets, okay, they are points of intersection of the moon's orbit with the earth's orbit. Okay, so they are points of intense darkness. Okay, and these points are known as nodes. Okay, and these nodes have immense energy to alter a person's life. Okay, so in Vedic astrology, these are the 9 planets, that is Sun, Moon, Mars, Jupiter, Venus, Mercury, Saturn, Rahu and Ketu. Now, Moon is the most important planet in Vedic astrology. Why? Because in Vedic astrology, Moon represents the mind, it represents the emotions, okay? And Moon is also the fastest moving planet in the zodiac. Okay, that is, Moon will stay in one sign or one house for 2.25 days. Okay, so it covers the entire zodiac belt in 27 days. How do I get this 27 days? There are 12 signs, as you can see. And if the moon spends 2.25 days in one sign, multiply 2.25 by 12 and you will get an answer of 27. So the moon covers the entire zodiac belt in 27 days. Now, why am I telling you all this? Because it is through the moon that the nakshatras, the transits and all other calculations are determined. Okay, so the moon is the most important planet in Vedic astrology. Even your dasha calculations are done using the moon at the time of your birth. Okay. Now, at the time of your birth, the moon will be placed in one of these 12 signs. Okay. So, suppose the moon at the time of your birth was placed in the sign of Mesha or Aries. Then your Janma Rashi is nothing but Mesha or Aries. Okay. Suppose moon was placed in the sign of Capricorn at the time of your birth. Then what will be your Janma Rashi? It will be Makar Rashi. Okay. Moon was placed in the sign of Leo, say. Then your Janma Rashi is Sima Rashi. Okay. So the Janma Rashi is determined by the placement of the moon. Likewise, your Janma Nakshatra is also determined by the placement of the moon in the respective sign. Now we will first try to understand what exactly are nakshatras in the next slide. Now, in a layman's term, a nakshatra is nothing but a constellation or a collection of stars. Okay. So, there is a story which goes as follows. Brahma had a son called Daksha. Okay. And Daksha was the Prajapati. That is, he was the lord of the universe. Okay. Of the earth and the skies. All right. Daksha Prajapati had 27 daughters. Okay. And when his daughters grew up, he wanted to marry them to a handsome person. Okay. So the moon at that time was the most handsome person, you can say. Okay. And so as it happened, Daksha Prajapati married his 27 daughters to the moon. Okay. So these 27 daughters which are married to the moon are known as nakshatras in Vedic astrology. All right. Now, to represent these nakshatras, what was done was, again, the space surrounding the earth was divided into 27 equal parts. Okay. Now, imagine that the space surrounding our earth is a circle. A circle is 360 degrees. Okay. You divide this by 27. Okay. Then you will get, divide this by 27. Okay. Then you will get an arc of 13 degrees, 20 minutes. Okay. So you will get 27 arcs of 13 degrees, 20 minutes. Now each of these arcs is known as a nakshatra in Vedic astrology. Now there is one more interesting story here. Now the moon had 27 wives. Okay. And he had to spend equal time with each wife. Okay. So the moon is constantly moving through the zodiac belt, and the zodiac belt is now divided into 27 parts. Okay. So each of these parts is like a lunar mansion. Okay. So it is a place where the moon goes and stays. Okay. So as we saw earlier in the earlier slides, okay, we saw that the moon takes 27 days to complete one round around the zodiac belt, right? This means the moon spends one day in each nakshatra. Okay, the moon spends one day in each nakshatra. All right, and that way he covers 27 nakshatras, okay, in 27 days. Now the moon had a special preference for one of Daksha Prajapati's daughters. Her name was Rohini. Okay. Now Rohini is the name of a nakshatra. So each of these nakshatras has a name. Okay. And all these nakshatras are female entities. Okay. So the moon was especially fond of Rohini. And therefore, when the moon is placed in Rohini nakshatra, the moon is exalted or very strong. Okay. So this was how the nakshatras come into being. Okay. That is, you divide the zodiac belt of 360 degrees by 27 and you will get 27 arcs of 13 degrees 20 minutes. Each of these arcs of 13 degrees 20 minutes are known as nakshatras. Okay. So, as we saw earlier, there are 12 houses in Vedic astrology. Okay. And each of these houses contain two or more nakshatras. All right. Correct. Two or more nakshatras. So say Makar Rashi is there. Makar Rashi will contain some nakshatras. Okay. So Makar Rashi contains Uttarashada, Shravan and Dhanishta Nakshatra. Alright, now we will come to see how this happens. Okay. So, the previous slide talks about the mythological story. Now, look at this picture very carefully. Okay. So, here you see 12 signs again. Okay. So, you have Mesh, Vrushabh, Mithun, Karka and so on up to Meen. There are 12 signs. Okay. Now, each of these signs contains two or more nakshatras. Okay. So, for example, the sign of Mesha or Aries contains three nakshatras. Alright, one is Ashwini, Bharani and some portion of the Kritika Nakshatra. Now, the Kritika Nakshatra also spills over to the next sign. That is, it is also there in the sign of Vrushabh. Alright, then the sign of Vrushabh has some other Nakshatras also. So, you can see the sign of Vrushabh has the Rohini Nakshatra and the Mrigashira Nakshatra. Okay, likewise, the sign of Mithun again has some portion of the Mrigashira Nakshatra, followed by a Nakshatra called Ardra, Punarvasu, okay, and so on, right? So, what I am trying to say is that each of these signs in the horoscope, they contain two or more Nakshatras, that is almost 2.5 Nakshatras, okay? So, two Nakshatras and half portion or incomplete portion of the next nakshatra. Alright. Now, in this, you can see something called as padas. Okay. Now, what do I mean by padas? Now, we know that each nakshatra is 13 degrees, 20 minutes in length. Okay. 13 degrees, 20 minutes in length. Now, divide this arc of 13 degrees, 20 minutes into four equal parts. Okay. Then you get an arc of 3 degrees 20 minutes. Now this arc of 3 degree 20 minutes is known as a pada. Okay. So every nakshatra has 4 padas or 4 subdivisions. Alright. So Ashwini nakshatra will have 4 sub portions. Okay. Bharani nakshatra will have 4 sub portions. As you can see in the sign of Aries. So in the sign of Aries, you can see that it has the Ashwini Nakshatra. Ashwini Nakshatra has 4 subdivisions or padas. Next Nakshatra is Bharani. Bharani also has 4 subdivisions or padas. And then the next Nakshatra is Kritika. Okay, but the complete Kritika Nakshatra does not fall in the sign of Aries or Mesha. Some portion of it spills over to the sign of Taurus or Vrishabh. Okay, so only the first subdivision or the first pada of Kritika lies in the sign of Mesha. The second, third and fourth pada of Kritika falls in the sign of Taurus. So if you look at this diagram, you will realize that every sign contains some nakshatras. Okay, so every sign contains almost 2.5 nakshatras. So you can think of nakshatras as chambers within a house or rooms within a house. Okay. So the chamber or the house, let us say Mesh Rashi is the house. Okay. So Mesha, the sign of Mesha has three chambers. One is Ashwini, one is Bharani and another is Kritika. Likewise, the sign of Vrushabh again has three chambers. One is for Kritika, one is for Rohini and one is for Mrigashira. Okay, so you can think of nakshatras as rooms within a house. Okay, so each sign is subdivided into rooms and each of these rooms is called as a nakshatra. Okay, now each of these rooms is given a name. So because there are 27 nakshatras, there will be 27 nakshatra names. Okay, so the Mesha Rashi has three nakshatras: Ashwini, Bharani and Kritika. Vrushabh Rashi has Kritika, Rohini, Mrigashira. Mithun Rashi has Mrigashira, Ardra and Punarvasu. Karka Rashi will have Punarvasu, Pushya and Aslesha. Siva Rashi will have Nakshatras Magha, Purva Falguni, Uttar Falguni. Kanya Rashi will have Uttar Falguni, Hasta and Chitra Nakshatra. Then the sign of Tula has three Nakshatras, Chitra, Swati and Vishakha. Sign of Scorpio or Vrishik has three Nakshatras again, Vishakha, Anuradha and Jyeshta. And sign of Dhanu again has two complete Nakshatras, that is Mula and Purva Ashada, and the first Pada of Uttar Ashada. Sign of Makar has the first and second Padas of Dhanishta. Okay, all four Padas of Shravan Nakshatra, and second, third and fourth Pada of Uttar Ashada. Okay, likewise sign of Kumbha has Purva Bhadrapada, Shatabhisha and Dhanishta Nakshatra, and the last sign, that is Meen, has Revati, Uttar Bhadra and Purva Bhadra. Okay, Nakshatras. Now each of these Nakshatras are represented by a female entity, and as we know, every human being has a different character. Okay, so some may have a tendency to get angry very easily, some may be very spiritual, some may be jealous, okay, some may be very helpful, some may be very generous, okay, some may be very harmful. All right, so likewise, what I'm trying to say is every nakshatra has a different characteristic, okay, because all humans are different. Okay, each human has a different nature. Likewise, nakshatras are nothing but constellation of stars, and each group of stars has a different nature. Okay, so in the next portion we will look at the nature of every nakshatra. Okay, so when a planet is placed in a particular nakshatra, the characteristics of that nakshatra get associated with the characteristics of the planet. Okay, and the prediction changes accordingly in Vedic astrology. Now in this video we will try to limit ourselves to understanding the various nakshatras in Vedic astrology. Now the moon moves through all the nakshatras, right, sequentially. Now every nakshatra is also associated with a planetary lord. This is the table which shows the planetary lord for every nakshatra. Okay, so you can see there are total 27 nakshatras, and for Ashwini, Magha and Mula nakshatras, you can see the lord is Ketu. Okay, you can see that for Bharani, Purva Falguni, okay, and Purva Ashada, the lord is Venus. Okay, likewise for Kritika, the lord is the sun. For Rohini, the lord is the moon. For Mrigashira nakshatra, the lord is Mars. For Ardra, Swati, Shatabhisha, the lord is Rahu. Okay, for Punarvasu, Vishakha, okay, the lord is Jupiter. And for Pushya, the lord is Shani, and so on. Okay, every nakshatra will have a planetary lord associated with it. Okay, so now when I say the nakshatra has a planetary lord, what does that mean? Now suppose let us take the Ashwini nakshatra. Okay, all the planets are continuously moving through the zodiac belt. Okay, now say at some point Ketu enters the Ashwini nakshatra. Okay, now Ashwini nakshatra falls in which Rashi or which house? It falls in the sign of Mesh. Okay, now Mangal or Mars is the lord of Mesh Rashi. Okay, and he is an enemy of Ketu, but still when Ketu comes into Ashwini nakshatra, he is very comfortable here. Okay, because he is the lord of Ashwini nakshatra. So despite being in the Mesh Rashi, Ketu is still not very bad here. Okay, because he is the lord of Ashwini nakshatra. Now look at this picture carefully. Okay, it shows the planet and the nakshatras he rules over. Okay, so for example, Ketu will rule over three nakshatras, Ashwini, Magha and Mula. And Ketu's Mahadasha, okay, Mahadasha is a period when a planet affects your life the most. Okay, so Ketu's Mahadasha lasts for 7 years. Okay, Venus Mahadasha lasts for 20 years. Sun's Mahadasha is for 6 years. Moon's is for 10 years. Mars or Mangal Mahadasha is for 7 years. Rahu's Mahadasha is for 18 years. Jupiter's is for 16 years. Saturn's Mahadasha lasts for 19 years. And Mercury's Mahadasha lasts for 17 years. So if you add the sum of all these Mahadashas comes to 120 years. Okay. So each planet rules over certain nakshatras. So Venus rules over Bharani, Purva Falguni, Purva Ashada. Sun rules over Kritika, Uttar Falguni, Uttar Ashada. So this table basically shows you the nakshatras and their planetary lords. Okay. Or look at it in a reverse way. Which planet is the lord of which nakshatras? That is clear from this table. Now look at this picture very carefully. Why nakshatras are important? Okay. So now when a child is born in a family, in the olden days, there was a tradition to give him a name as per the nakshatra. Okay. So when the child is born with Ashwini nakshatra, say, that is, he is born with the first pada of Ashwini nakshatra, then there was a belief that his name should start with Chu. Okay. So if he is born with the first pada of Bharani, his name should start with Li. So this is how nakshatras were also used to determine the name of a person. Or alternatively, if you knew the name of a person in the olden times, you could make out his nakshatra. Okay, so that was the significance of nakshatras in the olden times. As I explained earlier, every nakshatra has its own nature, right? Every person has a different nature. Likewise, every nakshatra has a different nature. Okay. So nakshatras, as per their qualities, are characterized into the following groups: sthir or fixed, okay, movable or chara, ugra or fierce, okay, swift or shipra, mridu or tender, and tikshna or sharp, and mishra or mixed. Okay, now what do I mean by a sthir or a fixed nakshatra? Okay. So sthir or fixed nakshatra is something, these nakshatras are considered favorable when you do any work which lasts for a long time. Example, you are buying a property. Okay, so that property is going to remain with you for a long time. All right, you are constructing a new house or you are getting married. Okay, you have to live lifetime with your spouse. So these are, if you marry when these nakshatras are in progress, okay, then it is said to be good luck. Okay, so there are three types of, so the fixed nakshatras are Rohini, Uttar Falguni, Uttar Ashada, and Uttar Bhadrapada. Okay, now there is another category of nakshatras which is called as Chara or Movable nakshatras. Okay, so now these nakshatras are mainly used to determine the mahurat, that is, what is the good time to do a particular thing. Okay, so if you are buying a vehicle is a movable thing, right? So if you buy it when the nakshatra of the day is a movable nakshatra, okay, that is, the moon is in a movable nakshatra on that day, then it is said to be auspicious. Okay, so the movable nakshatras are Punarvasu, Shravan, Swati, Dhanishta, and Shatabhisha. Okay, so every day there is one particular nakshatra, that is, the moon is placed in one nakshatra. Okay, so say today the moon is placed in the nakshatra of Shravan. Okay, he is in the sign of Capricorn or Makar and is placed in the nakshatra of Shravan. And you want to buy a car. Okay, so then if today's nakshatra is Shravan nakshatra, because Shravan is a movable nakshatra, it is considered good to buy a car on this day. Okay, there are of course certain other things which you need to look at when checking the Mahurat, but from a nakshatra point of view, if the day is associated with Shravan nakshatra, it will be a good day to buy the vehicle. Now there is a third category of nakshatras called as Ugra nakshatra or Fierce nakshatras. Okay, now these nakshatras are suitable whenever you want to do some destructive deeds. Example, you want to demolish a bungalow, you want to demolish a house, okay, you want to go for litigation, okay, then these nakshatras are considered good, okay, for that purpose. So the Ugra nakshatras are Bharani, Magha, Purva Falguni, Purva Ashada and Purva Bhadrapada. Okay, and there is one more category of nakshatras which are called as swift nakshatras or Shipra nakshatras. Okay, now these are Ashwini, Pushya and Hasta. Okay, now these are generally business minded people. Okay, so if you want to start a new business, if you want to do commercial transactions, okay, if you want admission in a school, okay, a college, or if you are giving and taking money, that is you are taking loans, etc. Okay, you are undertaking long-term journeys or travels, okay, then if you undertake these things, when this nakshatra is there, okay, that is the day's nakshatra is Ashwini, Pushya or Hasta, then you will benefit greatly, okay, and particularly if these nakshatras happen to fall on a Thursday, then it is considered as good, okay. Then there are mild nakshatras, they are called as Mridu or tender nakshatras, okay. So as you can see, there are four nakshatras in this category: Mrigashira, Chitra, Anuradha and Revati, okay. So these are you know, favorable for making new friends, going on a picnic, dancing, drama, fashion, okay. So these are auspicious if they fall on a Friday, okay. So if you do these things on a Friday and the nakshatra of that Friday is either Chitra, Anuradha or Revati, then it is said that you will greatly benefit by starting the activity on that day. There is a fourth category of nakshatras which are called as Tikshna or Sharp nakshatras. Okay, now actually these are bad nakshatras, I would say. Jeshta represents the eldest person, Mula represents the root of your family, okay. Aslesha represents a snake, right. So generally what happens is these nakshatras are favorable if you are filing for a divorce, okay. If you are evoking spirits, goblins, demons, etc. And these, if you look at these nakshatras, they are generally associated with Mercury and Rahu, okay, and Ketu. So these nakshatras, if you are doing these kind of things, it is considered as auspicious if these nakshatras are there and they happen to fall on a Saturday, okay. And the last kind of nakshatras are mixed or Mishra nakshatras, okay. So there are only two nakshatras in that category, Kritika and Vishakha, okay. And these nakshatras are favorable if you are doing some puja, if you are doing some worship, if you are doing some offerings to the fire, etc. Okay, and these nakshatras are there on a Wednesday and you are doing these activities, then it is considered as auspicious. Let us quickly cover the characteristics of each nakshatra, okay. Now the first nakshatra in the zodiac belt is Ashwini nakshatra, which is ruled over by Ketu, okay. It is represented by a horse's head, okay. So people born with Ashwini nakshatra, they are generally great physicians, they are great doctors, okay. And these people are very swift in their thoughts, okay. So Ashwini nakshatra is also represented by a deity called Ashwini Kumar. Ashwini Kumars are nothing but the physicians or the doctors of gods. Okay. So people born in this nakshatra, they have a natural inclination towards medicine, towards healing. Okay. And because Ketu is the overlord of this nakshatra, they also have intuitive powers. Okay. They have a sixth sense. So they easily get to know things which others cannot easily understand, okay, or things that may happen at a later date, these people come to know that easily, okay. Now if you look at the second nakshatra, it is the Bharani nakshatra, which falls in the sign of Mesha and is ruled over by Venus or Shukra. Now what do you understand by the term Bharani? In Marathi, Bharani is nothing but a container, right, a vessel which contains water, or a vessel which contains anything, okay. So Bharani means the person's life is full of wealth, is full of enjoyment, okay. But Bharani Nakshatra overlord or the deity is Yama, okay? And therefore, these people are highly treacherous generally. So if you have Bharani Nakshatra, it's difficult to trust that person. Now let us look at the third nakshatra. The third nakshatra is the Kritika Nakshatra. Kritika Nakshatra is ruled over by the Sun. Okay. Now Sun is always associated with what? Sun is the universal soul. Okay. Sun is also associated with the power. He is the king of all planets. Right. And Sun is also associated with ego. So all these characteristics come into the Kritika Nakshatra. Okay. So the Kritika Nakshatra people generally tend to gain a lot of power in life, okay, but at the same time they develop a lot of ego, all right, and generally these people are warriors, okay, they are very powerful people. The next nakshatra is the Rohini Nakshatra, which is the fourth nakshatra and is the moon's favorite nakshatra, okay. So a person with Rohini Nakshatra is extremely beautiful. He has very beautiful eyes, okay? And for this person, beauty is the most important thing in the world, okay? Because moon is associated with Maya. Moon is associated with illusion, okay? And people of Rohini Nakshatra tend to give a lot of importance to the physical beauty of a person rather than the inner beauty. The next nakshatra, that is the fifth nakshatra, is the Mriga Shira Nakshatra. Now Mriga means deer and Shira means head. Okay. So the symbol of this nakshatra is nothing but a deer's head. And again, this nakshatra is ruled over by the moon. Okay. So generally Mriga Shira Nakshatra people are very tender, kind, soft spoken. Okay. They are gentle like a deer. And therefore, the Varna is given as a servant. That is, these people are very loyal to their masters. The next nakshatra, which falls in the sign of Gemini or Mithun, is Ardra Nakshatra. Okay, Ardra Nakshatra is ruled over by Rahu. And the symbol of this nakshatra is a teardrop. Okay, and the deity of this nakshatra is none but Rudra himself. Now these people are generally very cruel. Okay, if you are born with Ardra Nakshatra certain padas, you would be very hard working. Okay, you would put in a lot of efforts, but you would be very cruel. Okay, you would not show any mercy to your enemies. So Ardra Nakshatra people are generally very cruel. Okay, the next nakshatra is the Punarvasu Nakshatra, which falls partly in the sign of Gemini and partly in the sign of Cancer or Karka. Okay, it is ruled over by Guru or Jupiter. Now the term Punarvasu represents a quiver of arrows, a place where arrows can be put, okay, while fighting a war. All right, so Punarvasu means to refill something. Okay, so these people are full of energy. Okay, they are always happy, enthusiastic and ready to do anything. Okay, these are good people actually. The eighth nakshatra is the Pushya Nakshatra, and this is known as the Sarvasreshta Nakshatra. Okay, so anyone born with Pushya Nakshatra, it means he has done a lot of punya in his previous lives. Okay, because the ruler of this sign is Saturn or Shani. Okay, now what this means is these people have done a lot of good things in their previous life. Okay, Pushya means to nourish. Okay, so they are tender, they are loving, they are caring like a mother. Okay, and they care and love people. They are very generous. They are good hearted. Okay, but there is a flip side to this Pushya Nakshatra. Okay, such people tend to be easily cheated by others. All right, so Pushya Nakshatra is considered as the Sarvasreshta Nakshatra. There is no nakshatra as sreshta as the Pushya Nakshatra. The next nakshatra is the Aslesha Nakshatra. Aslesha means to embrace someone, to coil around someone like a snake. Okay, and Aslesha Nakshatra is ruled over by Mercury or Buddha. Okay, so people of Aslesha Nakshatra, they are very sharp. Okay, they emit venom like snakes. Okay, when they talk, so you have to be very careful when talking to these people because they can get easily offended. Okay, and Aslesha Nakshatra, because it is represented by a snake, these people tend to have similar characteristics. Okay, so they are very poisonous when they speak. When they speak words, okay, it may easily hurt the person in front of them. All right. And Ashlesha Nakshatra people are very beautiful to look at. You may get easily attracted towards them, but you need to understand their nature and be very careful. The next nakshatra is Purva Falguni Nakshatra, which is ruled over by Venus or Shukra. Okay, now people born in this nakshatra are generally very spiritual, good-hearted, okay, but they crave for luxury in life. The next nakshatra is Uttar Falguni Nakshatra, which is ruled over by the Sun. Again, people born in this nakshatra are like warriors. Okay, they crave for power, they crave for money, they crave for respect. And that is the beauty of Uttar Falguni Nakshatra. Okay, so these people are warriors in real life. The next nakshatra is the Hasta Nakshatra, which is ruled over by the Moon. Okay, so Hasta Nakshatra people are very gentle, soft-spoken, good-hearted. Okay, generally these people are in a healing profession. Generally they become doctors, they become surgeons. Okay, they are associated with NGOs, etc. So Hasta Nakshatra represents work by the hands. Okay, and few of these people are also associated with business, such as banking, okay, with law, etc. Now generally these are very nice, noble people. Okay, the next nakshatra is Chitra Nakshatra, which is ruled over by Mars. Again, Chitra Nakshatra people are very nice, loyal to their masters, okay, and they can be relied upon very easily. Though this is ruled over by Mars, such people are not very aggressive. Okay, they are kind hearted and nice. The next nakshatra is Swati Nakshatra, which is ruled over by Rahu. Okay, so the deity of this nakshatra is Vayu or the wind. Okay, so such people are very restless, they don't have a stable mind. Okay, and they take very rash actions in life. Okay, so such people need to be balanced, they need to learn to control their emotions. Okay, the next nakshatra is Vishakha Nakshatra. Okay, Vishakha Nakshatra is also not considered a very good nakshatra. Vishakha Nakshatra is ruled over by Jupiter, yet the people with this nakshatra generally tend to have a lot of jealousy. Okay, though this is not the characteristic of Jupiter, generally Vishakha Nakshatra is associated with jealousy. Okay, such people are good, but when they see someone else prospering more than them, then they become jealous. Okay, and this jealousy leads them to do wrong things. The next nakshatra is Anuradha Nakshatra, which is represented by the symbol of a lotus. Okay, now what does a lotus represent in life? Okay, you know that lotus is seen in ponds, okay, where the substrate, the surface is very bad. Okay, so lotus represents coming out of bad situations and still being good. Okay, so a person born with Anuradha Nakshatra generally struggles a lot in life, but this is very good for his spiritual elevation. Okay, and the Anuradha Nakshatra is ruled over by Saturn or Shani, who is a karmic deity. The next nakshatra is the Jyeshta Nakshatra, which falls in the sign of Scorpio. Okay, it is ruled over by Mercury or Buddh. Alright, Jyeshta represents the eldest person in the family. Okay, generally if you are born with Jyeshta Nakshatra, okay, it represents that you will play the role of an elderly person in your family. Okay, you will be taking good care of others. Next nakshatra is the Mula Nakshatra, which is ruled over by Ketu. Now Ketu's nature is to take away the significations of the sign or the house where it is placed in. Okay, so generally Mula represents the root of the family. Okay, so for certain padas of the Mula Nakshatra are considered very dangerous. Okay, So if a person is born in certain padas of the Mula Nakshatra, the root of that family may be destroyed. Okay, that is the main controller of that family. He may be destroyed. Now let us look at the Shravan Nakshatra. Okay, Shravan Nakshatra is ruled over by the moon. Okay, the deity of this Nakshatra is Vaman or Vishnu. Okay, and the Nakshatra is represented by the three steps of Vaman. That is three steps of Lord Vishnu in his avatar as Vaman. Okay, and these people are very kind hearted. They are extremely loyal to their parents and they are self-sacrificing. Okay, so Shravan Nakshatra is the second most Shrestha Nakshatra after Pushya Nakshatra. Also, the deity of this Nakshatra is Vishnu, which means that these people have a chance to get moksha at the end of life if they do good things in this life. Next is the Dhanishta Nakshatra, which is ruled over by Mars, and the presiding deity of this Nakshatra is Vasu. Okay, Dhanishta Nakshatra is represented as a drum in the zodiac. Alright, now as the name implies, Dhanishta Nakshatra people generally aggregate a lot of wealth in their life. Okay, these people really crave for wealth and they get the kind of wealth they desire. Okay, so Dhanishta Nakshatra is good for material enjoyment, but not so good for your spiritual elevation. The next nakshatra is the Shatabitha Nakshatra, which is ruled over by Rahu. It is also known as Shatataraka, okay, which represents 1000 stars. Alright, now Shatabitha Nakshatra people are very hardworking. Okay, they put in a lot of efforts. Alright, but true to Rahu's nature, they are also involved in scandals and wrongdoings. Okay, and they earn wealth illicitly. The Purva Bhadra Nakshatra falls in the sign of Kumbha Rashi as well as in the sign of Meen. Okay, it is ruled over by Jupiter. And this nakshatra generally represents spiritual people. It represents priests. Okay, it represents gurus, etc. These people are also very good in nature. They are hardworking, but again they crave for material enjoyment. Okay, and despite being spiritual, they get entangled in the material world. The next nakshatra is the Uttar Bhadrapada Nakshatra, okay, which is ruled over by Shani. Okay, now these people are very hardworking. They suffer a lot of troubles but overcome these easily in life. The 27th nakshatra or the last nakshatra is the Revati Nakshatra. Okay, Revati Nakshatra is again ruled over by Mercury and the symbol is of a fish. Again, these people are very caring, loving, good-hearted, okay, and they make good friends. Revati Nakshatra is also one of the Shrestha Nakshatras. So friends, this was what I wanted to cover about nakshatras. Hope you enjoyed this video and learnt what exactly are nakshatras in Vedic astrology and their significance. My contact details are given in this slide. You can drop me an email at astrosevaworld@yahoo.com. If you want professional consultation, we have a mobile app on Google Play Store called Kamath Astrology. You can download the app and get consultation from me. Alternatively, you can visit my astrological website astroseva.tripod.com. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel Kamath Astrology if you like these videos. Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot.